Next on Unsolved Mysteries. After a San Francisco teenager strays into a world of magic, witchcraft, and mysticism, he's found dead at the bottom of a cliff. A young man is terrified when he comes face to face with a beast called Chupacabra. Authorities need your help to catch Carlos Berdea, who brutally murdered a young mother for no apparent reason. And when he died, this eccentric man left behind 50 empty coffee jars, 80 pairs of white socks, and an unclaimed fortune of $250,000. Whether it's murder, missing persons, or the paranormal, for the next hour, it's Unsolved Mysteries. I'm Dennis Farina. Join us. San Francisco, California. One Saturday in September, Kurt McFall, a 17-year-old high school student, drove from his home in Concord, California, across the Bay Bridge into San Francisco. He told his father that he was staying with a friend and would be home Sunday evening. Kurt never returned. On Monday, two bird watchers spotted a half-naked body on a remote beach below the cliffs of San Francisco Bay. Kurt McFall was dead.
Kurt told this friend of his that he was involved in some kind of satanic cult and that he wanted out, but thought that they might try to kill him. And he really feared for his life. It was a murder. It needs to be investigated. There's no doubt in my mind that Kurt could have handled himself in that cliff area because he was an experienced mountain climber. And he was a diver, so he would not have drowned in the water or fallen down the hill.
Kurt McFall was a handsome and popular high school student, a confident young man who made friends easily. But his father, Tom, has learned there was another side to his teenage son, a dark side that may have gotten him killed. In Kurt's room, Tom discovered a knife made from a deer's hoof, a necklace of stone and feathers, and drawings of witchcraft and violent fantasies. These seem to prove that Kurt was leading a double life. The year before he died, Kurt joined a group that enjoyed reliving medieval customs. They dressed in costumes and practiced sword fighting in the parking lot of an Oakland subway station. Kurt also joined another organization that initiated him into a pagan religion. This new group frightened one of Kurt's old high school friends. He later contacted Tom McFall and then began to fear for his own safety.
Gradually, over a period of perhaps 6 months, his attitude towards other people changed drastically. He kind of moved from just studying with an interest in medieval religion to actually adopting that religion as his.
Kurt's guide into the pagan religion was Gabriel Carrillo, who uses the ancient Welsh name Caradoc.
This is a religion which is also an art, a craft, which has techniques which are at their essence magical. I met Kurt because he had evinced an interest in magic. Kurt was real bright and real curious about just about everything.
His involvement with this group can be compared to a drug addiction, where you begin thinking that you've got it in control and you can take it when you want, but gradually losing that sense of knowing when to stop. Until you're a junkie.
I do not make any attempt to control people's lives. People are free to come and go at their own discretion, just as Kurt did. If anything, the emphasis that we have is on individuals taking control of their own lives.
On the last night of his life, Kurt stayed over at Caradoc's apartment. They had dinner, went to a movie, and around midnight, Kurt went swimming at Ocean Beach, a few blocks from Caradoc's home. According to Caradoc, Kurt had trouble sleeping and knocked on his door at about 3 in the morning.
It's too hot in here. I'm going to the beach.
Kurt was never seen again.
My best guess is simply that he took one too many chances. He might have gone swimming in the ocean and been pulled out by the undertow. He might have gone climbing on the cliffs at Land's End and slipped and fallen, or any one of a number of other things.
The following evening, Kurt's car was found abandoned on a golf course overlooking the ocean. There were a number of puzzling clues. Kurt's driver's license was on the floor, his car keys on the seat. A $20 bill was in the glove compartment. And the prized suit of armor which Kurt had made for sword fighting was missing from the trunk. There were also beer bottles scattered in and around the car.
The car has to be a phony scene. To me, that was set up because Kurt did not drink beer. That's also inconsistent with the autopsy report that shows that there was no signs of alcohol or drugs on the body when it was recovered.
At 10:15 the following morning, National Park Service lifeguards recovered Kurt's body. It was lying in a cove less than 2 miles from Caradoc's apartment, just below the cliffs at the golf course where Kurt's car was found.
When we came upon the body, we noticed it was in fairly good condition, fairly pale, usually a sign of being in the water for an extended period of time. No obvious external trauma. He looked pretty clean other than a few small abrasions on the body, but nothing obvious.
Kurt had no shoes, socks, or shirt. His back and shoulders were covered with cuts and abrasions. The belt he wore was missing its buckle.
With the facts that we have in this case, it's really anybody's guess as to where he actually entered the water, where he came from. My guess would be, and that's all it is an educated guess, that he simply fell off the cliff, and that's what it appears to me.
The coroner determined that Kurt died from multiple traumatic injuries and severe blood loss, but no one knows what caused those injuries. Perhaps Kurt died after stumbling over the edge, or perhaps he was pushed. The coroner ruled cause of death unknown.
I went to the San Francisco coroner and I said, "What do you think happened to Kurt?" And he said, "I think the most probable cause of Kurt's death is homicide." But he said he didn't have enough to testify to that in a court of law, and so he sent it up to homicide, classified as unknown. And I can't accept that.
The police investigated further but found no reason to change the ruling from unknown to homicide. They declined to be interviewed for this story. Kurt's father continues to believe that his son was murdered.
Kurt may have uncovered something in the organization and may have indicated to people that he was going to expose this. And I feel that all of these things probably contributed to them to wanting to do away with Kurt.
If I wanted to murder somebody, the last person I would murder would be somebody who was staying at my house and whose father knew that he was staying at my house. I mean, the whole thing is stupid.
Tom McFall hopes that someone will come forward with new evidence that could reopen the investigation. If you have any information regarding this case, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, a young mother vanishes in the middle of the night. What happened to Christy Jo Nichols? When a young mother of two small children disappears with no note and no explanation, well, people begin to wonder. When Christy Jo Nichols disappeared, her husband, Mark, was the last person to see her alive. Rumor has it that he knows a little more than he's saying.
People in small towns, they talk a lot. And a lot of these rumors tend to get pretty vicious. There's been a couple rumors that I chopped her up and put her in garbage bags and buried her at the dump. That's one of the first ones I heard. And that one really got to me, because I guess they were actually up there digging around.
It was in Gothenburg, Nebraska, that Christy married Mark Nichols. She was 19 years old and soon to be the mother of two toddlers who became the focus of her life.
Christy never felt she did anything until she had her children, and there was something she could look at and say, hey, I did this pretty well. Nobody can do this any better, because she was just so proud of her children. She loved them. I would have never thought that Christy would run away. She would have never left her children.
Mark, could you just wait out here for
10 days before she disappeared, Christy had gone to a local hospital after being injured in a fight with Mark.
The only bad fight I can remember is when I was trying to get her to stay home from going out. And she was getting so upset at me, she started to try to hit and kick me. And that's when she burned the side of my neck with a cigarette she was holding. And I tossed her onto the waterbed, and she landed wrong and kind of twisted up her thumb underneath her.
I saw Christy on the Friday after Thanksgiving. She came to the emergency room complaining of a sore thumb. She was acting like a scared rabbit, if you will. She's never been one for great eye contact or been very verbal. She obviously wasn't telling me everything either.
Christy told her cousin, Deborah Fredrickson, that she had been abused by Mark.
When I went to see Christy, she was working at the bar. When we left the bar, Christy showed me a bruise on her side. And it really scared me. I told her she needed to go get help from somebody. And I asked her how it had happened. And she said her and Mark had gotten an argument, and he had thrown her around. And she just acted like it wasn't a big deal. It was something that happened a lot.
As far as a violent argument, which there seemed to be a lot of rumors going around that I was always beating up on her. That's just totally wrong.
Oh, hi. 2 days before she disappeared, Christy went to see a divorce attorney. She didn't want Mark to find out, so she found an out-of-town lawyer.
What can I do for you, Christy?
We do a lot of divorce work. I've handled hundreds of divorces, but she had to rank up in the top five of being very distressed and upset and nervous and needed help. And when she explained certain abuses that she had been subjected to, we decided to make some telephone calls, to call the authorities and to report certain crimes that had taken place. I can say that the day that Christy was in my office on December 9th, she was not panic-stricken to the point that she would run or leave. And in fact, she had planned to come back. When she left, she had made an appointment to come back to my office.
The next day, Christy and Mark went Christmas shopping with their children. This was the last afternoon she spent with her family.
I felt real uncomfortable the day before she left, because I felt a lot of anger coming from her.
However, that evening, they hired a babysitter and went out to the local bar where Christy worked.
When I babysat the night that she disappeared, I was surprised that those two were going out, the both of them were going out, because I knew they weren't getting along.
When we were at the bar, things seemed to be going real well. I felt there was a good attitude about herself and myself, and a lot of laughing and carrying on.
Mark says that he and Christy left the bar around midnight and stopped at an all-night convenience store. According to the babysitter, Mark arrived home between 12:30 and 1 in the morning. The babysitter was doing her homework in front of the television and does not remember seeing Christy.
I was about 5-6 yards behind her when she reached the door. and she walked right by the living room where the babysitter was at, back towards the kids' bedroom, and went into the main bathroom.
It seems strange because Mark had paid me with cash when Christy usually pays me with a check. It was unusual for Mark to pay me. I really can't believe that I didn't see her, because I would have heard footsteps and I would have heard her go into the bathroom, because I was there between 5 and 10 minutes so that I would have been able to hear Christy somehow. But I didn't hear or see Christy.
According to Mark, Christy went to bed immediately after the babysitter left. He claims the last time he saw her was at 2 a.m. when he went to sleep beside her.
And that's the last thing I remember until my kids woke me up the next morning. And the first thing I noticed was she wasn't in the bed.
Mark says that he searched the house and noticed that Christy had taken a suitcase full of belongings with her. But both family cars were still sitting in the front yard. At 9:30 in the morning, Mark received a phone call from Christy's mother, who lived 100 miles away. Even though he knew his wife was gone, Mark told her mother that Christy was still in bed asleep.
I'll ever call you.
I didn't want to worry her at the time because I didn't know where she was, so I told her that she was still in bed sleeping because I didn't think she felt real good.
At 11:30 a.m., Mark took his children over to Christy's grandmother's and asked if she could take care of them so he could go search for his wife.
Well, I didn't think much about it at the time, but like I say later, he never asked me at all or telephoned me, you know, to take care of the kids, where they always did before. That was really about the strangest thing. He never asked if Christy was at my house or if I'd seen Christy. He just said that Christy was missing, and he acted like he was shook up.
I spent approximately 2 hours just riding around town trying to spot her, maybe coming out of a store, or I drove some residential streets where we knew some people.
When we checked out Mark's story about driving around looking for Christy, we could find nobody in the city of Gothenburg that had seen him driving around.
At 1:37 p.m., Mark filed a missing persons report with the police department.
I was real upset because there was no indication whatsoever that she would just pack up a suitcase and just leave.
During the investigation, it was discovered that Mark moved out of the house the day after Christy disappeared. A few weeks later, he boxed up all of her clothes and sold both of their cars. 3 months after she vanished, Christy's suitcase was discovered in a roadside rest area 30 miles west of Gothenburg. Police found it surprising that the contents exactly matched the detailed list of missing items that Mark had given the police when she first disappeared.
It had appeared to everybody present that the suitcase had been placed there instead of just thrown out. The items were neatly laying around. It was like person that put them there wanted them to be found. If my wife had left me, I wouldn't be able to look through the closet and tell you what she had taken. I probably would be able to tell you maybe what suitcase she had taken, but he was listing items of clothing right down the line and knew what she had taken.
The area surrounding Gothenburg has been searched extensively. No other trace of Christy Nichols has ever been found, and no one has ever been charged in the case. It remains open.
I'd have never done anything to hurt my wife. That's just the person I am. A lot of people think I'm a violent person. I'm not a violent person.
I hope and pray that she was alive, but if she isn't, I'd like to have her buried someplace where we'd know where she was.
I want very much for Christy to come home, but if for some reason she doesn't want to come home, you know, Christy, at least call somebody. You know, let us know where you are, whether you're all right.
Mark Nichols insists that he is innocent. But until Christy returns, he will remain under a cloud of suspicion. If you have any information about this case, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, in Puerto Rico, dozens of eyewitnesses believe they have seen a bloodthirsty creature called Chupacabra. The Yunque rainforest on the island of Puerto Rico is a lush tropical paradise. But eyewitnesses have reported that a mysterious beast lurks on the fringes of the forest here.
When it moved, I could see it had something here on its head. It was like a crest, but it moved and made a noise.
I felt like he was watching me because of certain movements made by his eyes. I could see three fingers on each hand, and on each finger, very long claws.
They call the beast Chupacabra, and it preys on livestock, pets, and small animals. It may look like a creature from a low-budget horror film, but these drawings are based on descriptions from dozens of eyewitnesses. In this day and age, it seems almost impossible that such a creature might even exist. Tales of the Puerto Rican monster have been dismissed as fantasy and imagination. Its attacks blamed on wild dogs or even monkeys. And yet, the sightings continue. The legend began when David Negron went out one September morning before dawn to check on his goat. He was startled to find it had been killed.
After I found the goat dead, I was standing there looking around, and that's when I saw the creature. It was black and hairy. It had large red eyes and a crest on top of its head. When I saw it, I felt scared and I began to run. I've never seen anything like that, and I've never been that scared before.
Later that day, the investigators from the Civil Defense Agency examined the goat. The only injuries they found were two small puncture wounds on the back of its neck. And yet, the goat was almost entirely drained of blood. The local press jumped on the story. The creature was quickly dubbed Chupacabra, the goat sucker. Over the next 3 months, dozens of similar attacks on small animals were reported.
In many occasions, these are puncture wounds, about, I would say, maybe a fourth to a half an inch in size, perfect circles. These small puncture wounds go into the animals. In most occasions, we have found that they seem to go right to the brain of the animals and kill the animals, affecting the brain and the nervous system of the animals. In other occasions, they go right straight into the animals in different areas, as if looking for certain organs.
Attacks have been reported all over Puerto Rico, with the greatest concentration in the village of Canovanas, 30 miles east of the capital city, San Juan.
There have been more than 100 animals killed. We're talking about 70 or 80 attacks. At the moment, we have some hysteria, some real problems, and some fear. I'm determined to resolve this matter.
Despite the hysteria, there were still many skeptics, among them police detective Eliezer Rivera.
I didn't believe in this Chupacabra. The people were just speculating, or perhaps because they were emotional or afraid, they exaggerated things. Personally, I never was convinced of these stories. I just never believed them.
That all changed one night as Rivera and a friend drove home from church.
I saw something strange on the roadside. I thought it was a puppet. But as I watched and observed the puppet, it began to move, and I thought, what is this? It had long eyes that were illuminated. It had fangs. It was hairy,
and it had three fingers with claws. When I opened the car door, the animal stuck out a long spike from his mouth. I interpreted this spike as a defense mechanism, so I sat back, closed the door, and kept watching.
In my experience as an investigator, we're trained to analyze and quietly evaluate things. But at that moment, I can't lie to you, I was scared. Now I know what's out there when people talk about Chupacabra. He exists. He is not any known animal. I tell you sincerely, what I saw was not of this world.
Most of the eyewitness descriptions are describing the same type of creature with the same details. They describe something beast-like, animal-like, with a strange type of head, more humanoid-looking, with big, red, luminous eyes, a flat nose, a small, slick-like mouth with some fangs protruding out from it, almost no ears.
Jorge Martin and a TV news crew asked veterinarian Carlos Soto to examine two rabbits allegedly killed by chupacabras. He was puzzled. There was a precise circular wound on the back of one rabbit's neck. The internal organs had been removed, and there was no sign of rigor mortis.
I thought, wow, this is something strange here, because this is not normal. On my 8 years in practice, I never seen that before. It was my first time to see something that odd.
A month later, Dr. Soto examined 20 dead birds. Each had been killed by a puncture wound to the back of the neck.
In the animal autopsies that I've done, the evidence does suggest that these animals were attacked by something.
Dr. David Morales, a veterinarian and spokesperson for the Puerto Rican government, doesn't believe the rumors of a strange, unknown beast.
Podemos pensar.
We think that they were attacked by dogs. They might be wild dogs. They could be vicious monkeys or could be tigers. There are a number of possible predators that could attack these animals in this way.
Something strange is going on. This isn't about dogs or monkeys or bats or anything like that. It's something very strange. And the creature that we're searching for is very intelligent.
These attacks can't be dismissed as accounts of drunken people or ignorant people, because we're talking about highly reliable people all over Puerto Rico who are witnessing these attacks, and these creatures too.
Ferocious attacks on domestic animals have been reported from Maine to Texas, from Colombia to Russia. DNA tests on some samples from some of the attacking animals show them to be diseased coyotes that have been made hairless by mange. But the chupacabra remains a mystery. Coming up, a young mother goes to work in a restaurant and is brutally murdered by a hot-tempered co-worker. A woman named Jean Molina had a dream, a frightening dream that she believed was a premonition of violence against her. This nightmare was so intense that Jean made drastic changes in her life, hoping to avoid the fate predicted in her vision. Little did she know that these changes would put her on a deadly path toward the attack rather than away from it.
She had had a dream that I was going to badly beat her up, and she felt that she should get out of my house. And I never understood why she would have a dream like that and believe that dream.
Jean Molina was raised in Merced, California. Following a tour of duty with the Navy, she returned home, married Frank Reed, and had three children.
We had a lot of fun. We had a lot of respect for each other. She just had all of the things that I've always wanted. I mean, she made me want to be married for a long time.
But when her youngest child was 2 years old, Jean needed a change in her life. She also wanted to escape the savage beating that was predicted in her dream. Jean left Merced and moved some 300 miles south to the city of Tustin. Her experience as a cook in the Navy helped her land a job with a restaurant chain.
within 6 weeks, she had been promoted. She was going to be training all of the new hires at each restaurant as they opened up. She had planned to take Joanna with her, so it was going to be a neat experience for her. She was real excited about it. She was real happy.
Jean had been at her job for about 2 months when she arranged for Joanna, her oldest daughter, to come down from Merced and live with her. Jean's parents agreed to drive 10-year-old Joanna to Tustin.
Jean was real happy because Joanna was going to come and live with her, and we made arrangements to take her down that weekend.
But when they arrived at Jean's home as planned, no one was there. Jean's parents then checked the restaurant where she worked.
Is Jeannie here? Jeannie Molina?
Jeannie, no. She didn't come in today.
Well, maybe we made a mistake.
The next morning, they went back to Jean's room, hoping to find her. There was no note, no clue to where she might be. Finally, they went to the local police and reported her missing.
Yesterday, we were supposed to meet with my daughter.
Deep down, I did know that something was very wrong, but I tried not to think about it because I knew that it would just make things worse.
Jean Molina was nowhere to be found. Her parents took Joanna back to Merced. Little did they know that on the same day they had driven to Tustin, a gruesome discovery was made in Westminster, a town 10 miles away. The badly crushed body of an unidentified woman was found near an abandoned construction site.
It was one of the more vicious crime scenes that we've investigated, and we've investigated an awful lot of homicides.
Just after daybreak that Sunday, a husband and wife witnessed a man acting suspiciously near his car.
He picked up some type of a large object, and we later found that to be a piece of asphalt, and with both hands above his head, just thrust it down hard, and then looked up and saw her, and in her words, she panicked, and he jumped back in this compact vehicle and sped off from the scene at a high rate of speed.
We didn't feel that robbery was a motive. She had some money on her. She had a ring on her finger. We felt that probably under the circumstances, the suspects that did this knew her in some way. They were trying to prevent us from finding out who she was.
I don't even know what race she is.
She was so badly damaged that we couldn't tell if she's a female, Asian, white, Hispanic.
An autopsy revealed that the woman had been sexually assaulted, strangled, and bludgeoned, then run over by a car. Jean Molina's landlord read a newspaper article about the unidentified female victim and thought that it might be Jean. He called the police, who contacted Jean's husband.
Possibly the most difficult thing in my life I ever had to do, to go down and identify somebody who was beaten so badly she was unrecognizable.
This ring was found.
It wasn't until Frank was shown the victim's ring that he was certain it was Jean. Despite Jean's dream about her husband beating her, investigators were able to quickly eliminate Frank as a suspect.
I've kind of come to believe that the dream wasn't about me. It was a dream about something else, and she had foreseen what was going to happen to her.
Detectives went to the restaurant and questioned Jean's co-workers.
Dana, the reason we're here.
One of the things we found out was that she had worked on July 16th, just about till 11 o'clock at night. One witness stated that she did come back after signing out on the time card. She did come back and talk to this particular individual for a few minutes.
That individual was short order cook Carlos Garcia Berdea. Jean might have gone with Berdea to celebrate her daughter's arrival. What she probably didn't know was that he had a history of violence and a hair trigger temper.
Carlos, Maria will never go out with you on account of you're ugly.
Carlos Berdea had threatened a fellow cook and then bragged about killing a man in Mexico.
Hey! Who do you think you're talking to, huh?
Hey, that's not funny!
Look at that! How's that?
Juegas conmigo. Yo te mato.
Yeah, I killed in Mexico.
Berheda then came back in, according to the person that we interviewed, the next day and had some kind of paperwork with him stating that he was wanted someplace in Mexico for an additional homicide.
He came in the morning, but he didn't show up at night.
Carlos Berheda quit his job the day that Gene disappeared. At Berheda's apartment, police learned that he and his common law wife had left suddenly on the day of the murder. That afternoon, another neighbor saw Berheda behaving strangely around his car.
Berheda was then seen attempting to clean out parts of the vehicle.
Wait, hold on.
When Berheda's car was later found abandoned, it provided police with even more proof that he was the killer.
Evidence not only in the vehicle, but on the undercarriage of the vehicle that secured, in my mind, with beyond a shadow of a doubt, that this was the vehicle that had been used to run over Gene Molina.
Authorities have been searching for Carlos Berheda ever since.
Well, I hope they catch him, and I just hope to be able to tell him what I think of him. Eres un cobarde. Te escondes abajo de la falda de tu madre. You're a coward, and you hide beneath your mother's skirts.
Carlos Garcia Berheda is in his late 40s, 5'7", and weighs 180 pounds. He may be using an alias and should be considered extremely dangerous. There are no warrants out for Berheda's wife, Leticia Herrera Estevez, but she is considered a person of interest. Both are believed to be living together in the United States. If you have any information, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, he lived at the Y, ate out for a few dollars a day, and left a $250,000 inheritance, unclaimed. Howard Drummond moved to the Lansing, Michigan YMCA when he was 74 years old. He rented a room for just $49 a week and chose not to pay an extra $5 a day to have a private bathroom. He always ordered the same breakfast, fried eggs, bacon, and rye toast for only $1.99. He also bought two extra breakfasts, packed them in his gym bag, and took them back to his room for lunch and dinner. Howard saved money and everything else. In his room, he kept 50 coffee jars, all empty. He collected hundreds of magazines and thousands of rubber bands. He owned 80 pairs of white socks and 8 identical suits and hats so he can wear the exact same outfit every day. Howard spoke to few people in the course of his day, but when he did, he was always polite.
Primarily, Howard had a very regimented lifestyle. He would pay his rent at a certain time every month, the same amount every month. His receipt, he would want stapled to a certain piece of paper a certain way every time it was done.
Every day, Howard went to the downtown Lansing post office to pick up the Wall Street Journal and his magazine subscriptions. He often received envelopes from banks and sent out registered letters to banks. Howard never failed to stop for a chat with postal worker Frances Dodge. She agreed to help him with his shopping, and he gave her the money to cover items he put on his list, which were written on the back of old envelopes.
I thought he didn't have anything. Why would anyone go around in the same clothes all the time? He just looked really poor to me. I always asked him why he wore that same hat all the time. And he said, well, it's not worn out yet.
After completing his daily routine in Lansing, Howard returned to the YMCA. Until he died at the age of 78, Howard Drummond never let anyone into his room. 2 days after Howard's death, a county-appointed attorney came to the YMCA. Since Howard left no will, Paul Rosenbaum was given the job of settling the estate and finding Howard's heirs. Looking for clues, Rosenbaum spread Howard's possessions all over the conference table at his law office.
It took probably 2.5 weeks to sort out everything. He had every single piece of paper from probably 25 years. He had a diary that was one of the most unbelievable things I have ever witnessed in my life, in which he kept an hour-by-hour account of the headlines in news stations across the whole United States. He had 3 watches that wouldn't work. There was thousands of used shoelaces, unlimited amount of newspaper clippings, with a lot of it had to do with the royal family and Princess Di. He was infatuated with her. It was unique, to say the least. To the best of my knowledge, he had 11 separate bank accounts from coast to coast, with $250,000 in cash in the bank accounts. And that $250,000 is not even the tip of the iceberg. He has a whole lot more money out there.
Strangely, the gin bag Howard always carried with him was not found in his room. Some say Howard kept his most important papers in that bag. Rosenbaum did find a key marked number 29. It seemed like a standard locker, the type you might find in a bus station. Could Howard's missing gym bag be in that locker? Could the papers inside help to identify his heirs? We know little about Howard Thomas Drummond. He was born in Houston, Texas in 1911 and was an only child. He served in the Army from 1942 to 1945. Drummond was once fired from a job at a California bank for stealing Scotch tape, and then he became a postal employee in Pasadena, California. He lived at YMCAs in Pasadena, Denver, and Dayton before moving to Lansing, Michigan. He died at the age of 77. Update. After our story aired, several heirs were able to prove their relationship to Howard Drummond. After attorney's fees, the inheritance was divided among Drummond's half-brother, niece, and nephew. The county has closed the case and is no longer looking for heirs.